this time, for example, when I wrote In Search of Klingsor, I was never in Germany, so I only tried to write about Germans, having read a lot of books about Germany, but never been there. This time I was in Russia for 2 months, more or less. But even being in Russia isn't exactly a vaccine to against stereotypes. Maybe always we have some, because some part of the stereotypes are always true.
I have a question for you, or kind of two-sided question. One, do you always do so much research for fiction, and do you consider that a prerequisite, or is that something that's just infinitely or inherently interesting to you in the creative writing? And also, secondly, I'm so blown away by the ambition of the trilogy that I'm quite curious, what will you do next?
Okay. Well, this was a very big project. I never imagined that I would spend more than 10 years writing these 3 books. But that was the time that I spent in this process. I first started writing In Search of Klingsor only because I love science and I wanted to write a novel about the world of science. That's the main reason of In Search of Klingsor. After that, I decided to write these 3 books about the history of the 20th century. And for these 3 books, yes, I made a lot of research. I love to do that. I wrote In Search of Klingsor in Spain, and the research for The End of Madness. At the time I was living in France, so I could do that there directly on the spot where I was, and the novel was about France, so it was easy. And for Russia, even if I traveled to Russia twice and spent 2 months there, the research was done not far from here at Cornell. So it was at the library of Cornell University that I made almost all the research for this book. And I loved that, and it's strange to have been very near from here writing about Russia that is very far from here. That's the way that the novels can work. But I love to do research for fiction, but I don't think it's a prerequisite for writing fiction. After this book, I had published 2 other fiction books in Spanish, small novellas. The first one is about Mexico and Iraq at the same time. But it's a book that is not a historical book, it's only about the 2 characters. One is an Iraqi woman, and the other one is a Mexican writer. And the second one, the second novella that I just published 2 weeks ago in Spanish, is again a novel more or less about Nazi Germany, a novella about Nazi Germany, but this time it is not an accurate novella that tries to portray the history of Germany. I choose an episode that I discovered when I was making the research for In Search of Klingsor, and I only try to understand what happened in this episode and how this episode tells a lot of things about humanity and about compassion and about evil without being so accurate through the facts, more like a parable or a fable about what happened in Nazi Germany.
The United States is sometimes attributed as being somewhat segregated from the rest of the world in terms of the literary scene. And I was wondering, and obviously the open literacy that remedy that. I was wondering that as you were either a student or even now, was there as much of a presence for international literature as there was a Mexican presence, or was it as segregated the United States is from the rest of the world?
I think a cool question.
He's talking about the fact that the United States tends to be insular.
Yeah.
And his murder of Mexico is similarly insular.
No, not at all. Well, it's very different. Globalization makes that the mainstream goes everywhere. And it's very difficult to the other countries to be in touch. So for us in Mexico right now, it's very easy to have access to American literature and to know very well all the great American living writers. But it's not the same here. Here, as we know, literary translation from other languages is very limited, much more than other countries. In Spanish, we translate in Spain and in Latin America around 30% of what is published. And the most part of that is from English. So we have the opportunity to know a lot of authors that is not possible the other way here, 3% of the published books are translated from other languages. And this 3% from Spanish is much less. So
the fact is, if you talk to any editor at any publisher, they'll tell you the same thing. Translations don't sell. And that's the end of the line. And really, if you look back, even to Garcia Marquez in 100 Years of Solitude, if you look at all those books that came out in Spanish in the 60s and were translated into English, that would be 100 Years of Solitude, Julio Cortázar's Hopscotch, Manuel Puig's books, Donoso, Vargas Llosa, a lot of those books, in fact, the bulk of them. If you go to the ISBN number and you open the book, you'll see that support for the publication of this book was provided by the Center for Inter-American Relations, which means that the translation received the subvention from what is now the American Society, and which was the David Rockefeller operation, among other people, but he was the founder of it. So, again, to get that stuff into English required an extra effort. This chat is only too aware.
You have a sense that would change?
Yes.
That's probably a good place actually to wrap up, but Jorge, I'm sure, would be happy to sign any copies of the books if anyone ends up purchasing one. And thanks again.